to him never ending in days. He is the Lord, and he comes in power when we call on his name. He is the Lord. Show your power, O Lord our God. Show your power, O Lord our God, our God. Your gospel, O Lord, is the hope for our nation.
You are the Lord.
It's the power of God for our salvation.
You are the Lord.
Well done to our band this morning. You can tell that we're in holiday mode here, but it's so good to see you this morning. Those who have made it on this beautiful sunny day that wasn't expected today, because we're supposed to have rain and thunderstorms, and to those of you who are joining us online as well. Welcome to our young people who are up there, and a special welcome today to two people that I must mention. A warm welcome to Rachel, coming back from Singapore after 2 years. Yes. You people can't see her, and she's down here, so you'll have to talk to her afterwards. And a warm welcome to Lewis, who's come back from his travels as well. Woo! We are so glad to see you. We're glad to see everybody this morning who's made the effort to be here. But you will appreciate that we're glad to have these people back with us after all their travels. And we hope that soon they're going to be able to share with us something of where they've been, what they've done, and how the Lord has blessed them while they've been away on the other side of the world. Anyway, lovely to see you all this morning, and welcome to those joining us online, as I say. Welcome to our worship time together. Philippians 2, verses 5 to 11 reminds us that we must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of the highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Beautiful words written by the Apostle Paul to the Philippians. And we're going to repeat them together, really, as we join in singing what we've just read, which is in Psalm 74 in our songbook. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess him, King of glory now. 'Tis the Father's pleasure we should call him Lord, who from the beginning was the mighty word. I'm going to invite you to stand together, and we're going to sing with the band verses 1, 2, 3 and 5. So four verses straight through. Thank you very much, Mark.
Thank you.
Amen. What a beautiful song. Please be seated. And we thank the authors for such beautiful music. We're going to continue to think about this wonderful Jesus that we know as our friend and our Saviour. I hope that's true for you this morning, that you do know him as your friend and Saviour. And we're going to sing Jesus, what a beautiful name, Son of God, Son of Man, the Lamb that was slain. And he goes on to talk about all the wonderful things that Jesus gives us when we live our lives for him. Joy and peace, strength and hope and grace that blows our fears away, love and freedom, life and warmth. And it says again, grace that blows our fears away. And forgiveness and security, power and love, and grace that blows our fears away. Do you live a life of anxiety or anxiousness or worry or fear for the future? This song tells us that God's grace is sufficient and can do away with all of that if we trust in that beautiful name. We're going to sing this song, which is number 87, for those who follow in the songbook. Then we're going to have a time of prayer. I'm going to ask John to continue to play the tune for us. Then Miriam's going to come and pray. She's going to pray for our world and the people that are anxious and people who are going through difficult times at the moment. We want to remember those still affected by the war in Ukraine that seems never ending. That peace may come to troubled and proud hearts. That the people may be able to feel hope and love and freedom. We want to pray for them this morning. She's also going to pray for us, for each one of us, as we seek to live our lives daily for the Lord. And many times, if we're honest, we fail, don't we? And forget all the things that we are going to be reminded about as we sing. So we want to ask the Lord to help us with that. So let's join together in singing this song, song number 87. And then Miriam's going to come and pray after a time of reflection. Thank you, John. Pray just as John continues to play for us. Then Miriam will lead us. Thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Father God, as this new day has begun, we come to meet with you in worship and praise, thanking you for guiding us through this past week. You gave us Jesus so long ago, and it is in his name that we come, that beautiful name that has been on our lips as we sang. The name that is the Son of God and also the Son of Man. The beautiful name that pours into our hearts all that we need to live abundantly. We have sung of a name that is so full of joy, so full of peace, abounding in strength, pouring into us hope, love, and freedom, healing from our pain. All of this is so graciously and freely given to us, beauty that we can receive right now as we bow before you, here as we are gathered together, or in the home where you are right now. Jesus is close to us. Jesus is with us. Jesus is giving to us exactly what we need. And as we receive so much of these blessings and realize that these are for all of your creation, we want to bring our world to you. It seems it's in such confusion at the moment, and the little word why is so often on our lips. Why are there areas of so much conflict, Lord? Let us pause to bring Ukraine before you as we pray on our own in this silence, just where we are. And we ask you why so many need to search for places of safety, crossing dangerous waters, crowding into boats that might collapse, running away from gunfire, fleeing through countries that are not even safe for them to pass through, just so that they can find a place of safety. And so again, we want to pause before you to bring you refugees, especially those from Ukraine and those from Afghanistan, who are having a tough time at this moment as they are being asked to leave the places where they have already found refuge in this country. Let us pause and bring refugees before the Lord right now. We also ask you, Lord, what is our role in all of this? How can we let them know of this joy, love, and peace which is so freely given? We need you to show us, Lord, and to fill us with your love and your presence as we spend this vital time in you on this Sunday morning. And so we pray for us who are meeting here. We pray for each other. We have greeted those who have returned safely to us. And that gives us joy too, Lord. We also pray for those joining us online. We don't know where they are. We don't know their situations. We don't know if people are struggling with health. But Lord, they have joined us through the medium that you have helped mankind to create. so that they too can worship you and feel your presence and know your joy, your peace, your strength, your hope, your love and your freedom and your healing power. We also want to pray for those who are on holiday at the moment, enjoying a time of rest. May they be aware that Jesus too took time away to rest and refresh himself in your presence. And we pray for those who are attending summer camps, some already there, some are about to go. We pray for this, our country, this, our world. And it is our prayer, Lord, that the grace that blows all fear away will allow the beauty of the name of Jesus to be seen and felt by all who gather in your name today. In the beautiful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Miriam, for leading us there. Now, we have been blessed by our summer songsters. They've done so well over the last few weeks, and we're pleased to have them again with us today. And they're going to bring a beautiful song to us this morning with words by Commissioner Harry Reid and music by Colonel Robert Redhead. Become aware of him. Thank you.
Songsters.
Amen.
Amen.
As they come.
thank you very much for that beautiful song, Become Aware of Him. He's ever at your side. Lovely words for us this morning. Thank you, songsters. Now, Lieutenant Colonel John Rowlands is going to come and read to us from Luke's Gospel, Luke chapter 2. Thank you, John.
From God's word, Jesus speaks with the teachers. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the Passover festival. When Jesus was 12 years old, he attended the festival as usual. After the celebration was over, they started home to Nazareth. But Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents did not miss him at first because they assumed he was among the other travelers. But when he didn't show up that evening, they started looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they couldn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to search for him there. Can you imagine? 3 days later, they finally discovered him in the temple, sitting among the religious teachers, listening to them and asking questions. All who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. His parents didn't know what to think. "Son," his mother said to him, "why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been frantic, searching for you everywhere." "But why did you need to search?" he asked. "Didn't you know that I must be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he meant.
Thank you, John, for bringing us that reading this morning. Now, our band's going to bring us their contribution to our meeting this morning. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for that beautiful reminder. Now there's an opportunity for all of us to join in as we continue to sing about the name of Jesus. And we're going to sing a song that says there is beauty in the name of Jesus, there's salvation in the name of Jesus, and there is rapture in the name of Jesus. Words based on Peter's words to the Sanhedrin, right back at the beginning of the early church, as we read. And we can read in Acts chapter 2, where Peter tells those present that salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. It's a song that tells of the experience that we can all have, their salvation in the name of Jesus, trusting in his name alone, we will find ourselves at last presented faultless at the Father's throne. So I invite you to stand. It's Psalm 95 for those who like to follow it in the songbook. And we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4 straight through. Thank you very much, band. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. And Cheryl's going to come and bring us the announcements. And then Nigel's going to come and pray with us before our offerings today. Thank you very much, Cheryl.
Good morning. It is indeed lovely to see you all here today. I hope you've all received your email copy of the bulletin. If you don't get it online, then would you please either speak to myself or John Swansbury and let us have your email address so we can address that situation, please. But the bulletin does contain lots of details that I can't give you. It's got some nice photos in there as well that I can't share with you. So please look at your bulletin and gather all the news and things that you need to know about from there. If I can remind the blue badge holders, if you could, again, let John Swansbury know, or Sara and Edgar, we're looking at reforming the inner car park, and we need to know how many blue badges spaces we need to have. So if you could do that, we will be very grateful. On Wednesday this week, the Home League will meet at 10 o'clock for 10:30, and the subject is neighbours. Now, whether you're coming to talk about your neighbours, whether you're going to have a visit from the Australian neighbours, or what, I just don't know. So you'll have to come and find out. 10 o'clock for 10:30 on Wednesday of this week. Next Sunday, our meeting will be led by Lieutenant Colonels Sara and Edgar. The following week, on the 20th of August, we're having a Songs of Praise meeting. Now, there's been a list up in the foyer for you to put up your favourite songs that you would like to sing. If you haven't added to that list, then please do so today. The paper is running out. We might have to put up a new list, but the list will be closing today. So if you have a favourite and you'd like to sing it on the Sunday, hopefully, if we have time, then please do add your favourite song. Moving into August, I'm advised that there are no tickets left now for the welcome to the General and Commissioner of Buckingham at the Regent Hall. I don't know if it's going to be streamlined online. I guess we'll know nearer the time. 16th of September, Saturday, please keep that date free. It is the proposed date for the big collection, and we will all need to be out in force to hopefully gather as much money as we can. On Sunday the 24th of September at 4 p.m. at the William Booth Training College, we have the inauguration of this new London division that we are part of now. and there will also be the installation of our new divisional commanders. This is going to be a ticketed event again. As you know, the training college only has limited seats, so you will need to pre-book your tickets, please. And I understand that the booking system opens tomorrow, but I don't have a link, and I don't think we have a link currently. Hopefully, when the link arrives, we can pass it on to you. But please be aware that you do need to book those tickets quickly, because they will go quickly. And back to today. We have refreshments following this meeting in the community hall, where you have a chance to catch up with Lewis and with Rachel and all the news over the past year. I'm sure they've got lots to tell us. It is so good to have you back with us. There will not be an open air this morning, and thank you very much for listening.
A verse from a song before I pray. From thy thankful people, from each grateful home, as thy hand hath given, to thy hand shall come. Love for help is seeking, knocking at each door. All thy children gladly give thee more and more. Father God, we are thankful people. We thank you that you give us so much. We pray, Lord, from what you have given us, we will give back to you what is rightfully yours. We pray, Lord, that you will use those gifts as they need to be used within this community where there are so many needs. We pray, Lord, for those people that will be our hands or your hands to the people. And we ask, Lord, that you will bless them and that you will bless the people that receive from you and that they will want to know more about you. We pray, Lord, through that interaction that questions will be asked, that your love will be shown and your compassion. And we ask this in and through your precious name. Amen.
As we give our offering this morning to the Lord from the abundant resources that he's given to us, we're going to meditate on the words of a song that we're going to listen to. And the words say, Jesus, oh Jesus, is all I can say. Jesus, the name that my heart sings all day. Jesus, what wonder to me that I may be with you forever and ever to stay. Please listen attentively as you give and prayerfully. Thank you, Graham. Thank you.
Dear Lord Jesus, we do love you and we do want to be the people that you want us to be. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will speak to us and lead us as we reflect now on the texts that may be well known to us. But we know that your word can come always in a new way. It can come alive in a different way because it's living word. And we ask that your Spirit will speak to us in a new way today as we listen. Amen.
Hallelujah. So nice to see you, Rachel. I hope you feel welcome as well. And Lewis as well. Hope you feel welcome back to your home, to your community, to your family as well. What can be more meaningful to our faith as salvationists than the life and death of Jesus Christ? And what can be more meaningful to Jesus than his identity? So for the next two Sundays, we are going to take time to reflect on Jesus' identity and let Scripture remind us of who Jesus was. But we are going to unpack it by answering two fundamental questions. Who did Jesus say he was? And who did other people say Jesus was as he lived his life here on earth? And to start with, it would be interesting to see how was Jesus announced throughout history. It's interesting to start by analyzing how the Old Testament texts announced the coming of Jesus Christ as they provided us with an insight into his identity. The prophet Jeremiah, for example, announces him as the one who would be responsible for inauguration of a new era in the relationship between God and man through the establishment of a new covenant. The prophet Isaiah announced him as a suffering servant, acting in obedience to God to inaugurate a new time also. Other prophets and the psalmists announced him as the Messiah. Daniel says about him using the title the Son of Man. Just to mention a few of the Old Testament texts. But Jesus was also announced in the Old Testament as one who was going to be born of a woman in a specific time and in a specific city. And that is, of course, what we remember and celebrate at Christmas. So, on the one hand, we have a human being that is born of a woman who grows up as any other person that needs to learn to speak a language in his family environment, that learns the customs and behavior of a specific culture, and so on. And on the other hand, he was somebody who from the early age as 12 was already aware of his unique relationship with God, referring him as his father. As the experts say, what the Bible presents to us about Jesus leads to what they call a paradox. Jesus being on the one hand 100% man, and on the other hand 100% God. But that's another subject altogether to be explored another time. So let's start to answer the question that we are dealing with today. Who did Jesus say he was? As we already read earlier, Luke 2 shows us that Jesus has a unique sense of relationship with God as being his father. In his answer to Mary as to why he was in the temple, why Mary and Joseph were looking for him, with a boy's mind, he replied as if it was the most natural place to be. In each of the Gospels, we read about Jesus doing things to help people, forgiving sins, teaching about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, and telling them about himself so that people would be clear about who he was. But on different occasions, Jesus referred to the Old Testament texts and showed how they spoke about him. As, for example, in Luke chapter 4, in that situation in which he is in a synagogue, and he stand up and to read, and somebody gave him the book to read. He looked for Isaiah, opened, and read Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. And then he sat down, people looked at him, if he was going to say anything, and he said, "The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day." So he understands he is, and he wants to make clear to the people that he is the anointed one that is going to bring good news and doing all those things the prophecy was announcing in so many years ago. In another text, further on in Luke chapter 22, Jesus talked about the new covenant God was about to make with his people. When after the Last Supper, he takes this cup and mentioned this cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood poured out as a sacrifice for you. He brings to mind the prophecy in Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 32, 33, and 34. That text actually starts saying, "The day is coming when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and Judah. This covenant will not be like the one I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand and brought them out of the Egypt. This is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel after those days." And then he says that he's going to put my instructions deep within them and I'll write them on their hearts. A covenant based on the personal relationship and based in love. Another example, in the Gospel now of Matthew, chapter 21, Jesus was to come into Jerusalem and ask two disciples to go into the village and find a donkey in a specific house. And he had in mind, when he asked those disciples to do that, he had in mind a prophecy in Zechariah about the peaceful and humble nature of the Messianic King, and applied this prophecy and its teaching to himself. And also, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, Jesus affirmed in his preparatory conversation with those who followed him for the things that were going to happen, preparing them, that all of you will desert me, for the scripture says. And then he applied to himself again a prophecy in Zechariah about what was going to happen to the disciples when he was arrested and trial would take place to try and find a way to condemn him. In the same chapter, further down, Mark chapter 14, Jesus answers the high priest's questions, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" with a prophecy that reveals his identity as one with God and his kingdom. "Yes, I am who I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated in the place of power at God's right hand. But in his words, he quotes actually a vision from the book of Daniel. When we read in chapter 7, as my vision continued that night, wrote Daniel, I saw someone like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the unseen one and was led into his presence. He was given authority, honor, and sovereignty over all the nations of the world, so that people of every race and nation and language would obey him. His rule is eternal. It will never end. His kingdom will never be destroyed. Again, he applied to himself that vision of Daniel, which was actually a prophecy. And also, in John chapter 5, Jesus applied to himself the Old Testament text in general when he claims to be the Son of God as part of a long explanation to the religious leaders about the reasons why, in their understanding, he broke the Sabbath rules. That's just to mention some texts that I selected in each of the four Gospels. However, in John's Gospel, Jesus includes specific examples and comparisons to explain and make it clear who he is in a way that is beyond any possible questioning. In different contexts and situations, Jesus made 7 clear statements. John chapter 6, he says, I am the bread of life. Referring that he is the one who satisfies our most basic needs of hunger and thirst for a meaningful life. This affirmation comes after Jesus fed a multitude that was hungry after many hours listening to his teaching, and that had a small portion of food offered by a young boy. In John chapter 8, he declares, I am the light of the world. To walk in darkness is to walk towards death. To walk in his light leads to life. After this affirmation, Jesus cured a man born blind who was 42 years old. And then, further on in John 10, Jesus declares, I am the gate of the sheep. Who enters into the sheepfold, the place where the flock are kept safe through Jesus, will experience the care and safety that he offers from others, threat and hostility, and they will never be disappointed. Jesus is talking about the fellowship of the believers, to which every believer belongs. And he was referring to the disciples, to those who were around him. In another way, and in another words, Jesus was saying, here in this fellowship is your place where you find what you won't find in any other place or in any other person. Jesus was also explaining to the Pharisees who were around them, who relied on their careful fulfillment of the law, that their way of belonging to that fellowship was not enough. There is no other way or person that could enable them to enter and take part in that flock that is kept safe in the sheepfold other than through Jesus, who is the gate. And more, Jesus goes further to affirm then in John chapter 10, verse 11, I am the good shepherd. He never abandons the sheep of his flock. In other words, he takes an active role in keeping the sheep safe. He cares, he protects, he guides, he sustains, he saves, he forgives, he heals, and he frees them. The good shepherd does not run away in times of danger because he has no other interest in the sheep than to show his love for them. Then further on, chapter 11, another situation, he declares, I am the resurrection and the life. A very strong affirmation of Jesus in the midst of a tragic family situation in which Jesus himself was emotionally involved. This is the only one, the only affirmation, the only declaration in which his words are followed by a challenging question, because he's saying, he's affirming that to Martha. And then he asks, do you believe this, Martha? And Martha answered, yes, Lord, I believe. So, following the situation, she saw the glory of God in the resurrection of her brother Lazarus. Further on, he declares, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. We should notice that Jesus does not say, no one can go to the Father, but he says, no one can come to the Father. Because as he explains further on in that same text, he and the Father are one. Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father, affirms him. He is his declaration to Philip. When Philip asks, show us the Father. For Christians, the truth about life, and he said that to those first disciples, the truth about life is not some philosophical affirmation elaborated in a rational way. No, for true Christians, those who are disciples of Jesus, the truth is a person, Jesus Christ. He embodies all the truth about ourselves, about God, about our relationships, about life and its meaning and purpose. And lastly, Jesus declares, I am the vine, you are the branches. In Jesus' teaching to his disciples, he emphasizes that whatever happens in life, the connection with him is the source of any good that we may produce as his disciples. So as we can see, Jesus presents himself as being the bread, the water, the light, the gate, as well as the good shepherd, the resurrection and the life, the way, the truth, and the true vine, in very specific situations. But it's interesting because these statements that Jesus made about himself are far more than just words. Their meaning is played out in his lifestyle and the way he behaves and applies what he affirms to be. And by his actions and reactions in response to his own family and people around him. So Jesus is the light of the world, the bread and water, the resurrection, the life, the way, the truth, in many senses. To the ignorant, he brings wisdom. To the impure, he brings holiness. To the sick, he brings cure. To sinners, he brings forgiveness. To the oppressed, he brings deliverance. To those overcome by sadness, he brings joy. To those steeped in conflict and stress, he brings peace, and so on, and so on. You know, Jesus is so majestic that a single title is not enough to encompass all that he is, nor in a single metaphor capable of doing justice to his greatness. So yes, we can definitely affirm that Jesus is 100% man. A man involved in so many situations, living as a typical man of his time, relating to typical people of his time, facing suffering, misunderstanding, and frustration caused by the typical situations people around him were also living and suffering in their families, in their communities, in their place of work, in their relationships, and so on. And yet, Jesus' identity was profoundly linked to his unique, loving relationship with God as his Father. No one had ever called God his or her Father, as they couldn't even imagine the possibility of having an intimate relationship with God. But Jesus also expresses through his own life and in words and deeds, how God is longing to have this same loving relationship with everyone, as he declares in his answer to Nicodemus in John 3, 7, 16 and 17. Words that we know so well, but was part of an answer that he was giving to Nicodemus. And so, Jesus lives his life loving those who are around him, whether they are open to his teaching and revelation, or if they hate him because of their own projects for power and personal interests, or even if they condemn him and are actually the ones that crucified him. He shows how much God loves each one of them. So yes, we can definitely affirm that Jesus is 100% God. So in conclusion, friends, in the end of the day, there are only two ways of dealing with Jesus and all who he has said. Either we accept him and believe in him, believe in what he revealed about God and what he did for you and me on the cross, and consequently live according to our faith in him, or you consider him a lunatic, not accepting anything that he said about himself and God and the purpose of his death on that cross and even the resurrection. You know, there are no other options. You must make your choice. Either Jesus was and is the Son of God, or then he's a madman, as C.S. Lewis says. If you are ready to accept part of his words, considering him just to be a great moral teacher, and you don't accept his claim to be God, that will not do either. You won't make sense of the words that he says it will be totally inconsistent to his life. So, brothers and sisters, at a time in which fake news is becoming more and more popular, and we are finding it increasingly difficult to identify the truth in all that we hear and read, let us hold on tight to Jesus, who is the truth, and to all that he said and did to save us from ourselves, to save us from our sins. And let us follow him to get to know him more and more, so that we can truly know who God is, to love him more and more. May God bless us. Amen.
And we're going to continue and sing about this wonderful, bounteous, majestic God who sent Jesus, as we've been talking this morning, Jesus who identified to us who he was. And we're going to sing Psalm 412. Come, let us sing of a wonderful love that's tender and true, out of the heart of the Father above, streaming to me and to you. Wonderful love dwells in the heart of the Father above. We're going to sing all four verses straight through, please. Wonderful love. Let us pray together.
Father God, through Jesus, you have shown us how much you want us to receive the love you offer. And yet you want nothing more than that we allow you to love us and enjoy that love. We thank you for sending Jesus so that we could know who you are and how much you love us. I'm sure you understand how hard it is for us to allow you to love us as we are since we always feel that we have to deserve the love offered to us. But thank you for Jesus that showed and helped us to learn that you want to offer your love to us, not because we have earned it, but because you have decided to love us independently of any effort on our side. Help us, Father God, to depend on our loving relationship with you through Jesus in such a way that our love for others may flow more and more from your wonderful love that is given to us undeservedly. And may the love we also offer to those around us be unreserved and an expression of our faith and trust in you, and not depending on their actions towards us. In Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen. Amen.
So we've spoken a lot this morning about the name of Jesus, and we're going to finalize our meeting, sing a beautiful song, words by General John Gowans and music by General John Larson from the musicals. But there is no other name but his name. I'm going to invite you to stand. It's song 96 in your songbook, and we're going to sing this song as we leave this place, knowing that there's no other name but Jesus' name for us to take with us today. Thank you, band. Brothers and sisters, let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. May it teach and counsel each other with all the wisdom that he gives us. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. And as you go forward to face the new week, whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Amen. May the Lord bless you. Have a good week and enjoy refreshments and fellowship together before you leave. Thank you.